got a huge background in not only real estate investments, but in the blockchain crypto space. How are you seeing blockchain technology impact real estate over the next decade?
Chris, I think there's a few things that come into play. It's one of the things that is key is the fact that understanding the difference between blockchain as the technology versus interchangeably being used for cryptocurrencies as well. Majority of the times people start thinking, hey, you know, when you're talking about blockchain, there's going to be crypto involved in some way or form. You know, as Sam talked about it, and then the person before me from DigiShares as well, it's a smart contract. It's the coding that really makes a difference. It's a distributed ledger that plays an immense role in completely changing the industry as we look at it today. So real estate being completely changed from a transactional perspective, from a data perspective, from the perspective of land registries, and then also from a trading perspective. And that's what we focus on is fractionalizing real estate and giving access to people, democratizing this space and bringing it in, making it more and more accessible for people who don't have access to it right now.
Yeah, so blockchain, as you were describing, it's the foundation. Cryptocurrency is a feature on that highway. On that foundation that's built, NFTs, securitized tokens. So there's a lot of things, and there's probably a half a dozen or several hundred other features that we just don't even, we haven't thought of yet. Let's go into STO. Since you're in investments, knowledgeable in STOs, this is what has me excited. How do you view the STO, or how is the STO process different than the traditional security process?
Yeah, so there's a lot of efficiencies that come into play when we start using blockchain and start utilizing STOs or security or start bringing on new security token offerings. Those efficiencies include the speed of transactions, the immutable nature, bringing the trust in the trustless environment, the instantaneous transactional process, and then added features that come into play with it as well. You know, traditionally, when you're looking at a real estate deal in the alternates world, you're looking at signing off on large VPNs and disclosures, and you have to wire money to an escrow company. You have to go over a whole bunch of paperwork that you have to sign off on, the formal operating agreements, and then see your K-1s and deal with all of that. And then from the sponsor side, it's a similar process where you have to not just create those documents, but then also have to manage them, investor relations, and all of those things make it a very tedious process. Once you have STOs, or once you start utilizing STOs for those offerings, and instead of going for traditional offerings, we go towards security token offerings, you're talking about one-click investing. You're talking about instantaneous transaction settlement. You're not waiting on escrow periods. You're talking about fractionalizing it down to as small a number as you want. St. Regis is down, it started off as a buck a share. You know, some others may have it up to 10,000 or 1,000 or 500, depending on how you want to value that asset. So STOs really change the game in terms of the speed of the transactions, the transfer agent aspect of it, and other intermediaries which you don't really need from a technical perspective anymore. Now, from a regulator perspective, you still need a lot of those intermediaries still in place to make the product function within the given circumstances that we have for SEC and FINRA and all the other 3- and 4-letter regulators out there.
Yeah, I want to get to tokenization and fractionalization, but first, from a platform standpoint, how long is it going to be before we get there to where it's as you describe, where it's one click done, as opposed to like now you have the platforms, then you've got the currency, which can be crypto versions or fiat. Then you have keys and public wallets, and like it's very clunky. Which don't fix that.
But I like to believe we fixed it, right? I like to believe we fixed it at a crew.
Talk about it.
Look, the reason why Coinbase is the single largest exchange out there for cryptocurrencies is because of the user experience for it, right? And there's no other way that you will get larger user adoption till you don't really solve for for that true experience, where you don't have to deal with those private keys and public keys. You don't have to download all these apps and all these wallets, and you don't have to manage these cold wallets or these cold storages in terms of these USB keys, like storage systems and stuff. You have to create a platform, or and that's what our thought process was when we created a crew, where it's a seamless process for users to sign on, just like they would in their email address, just like they would in their Gmail account or anything else. And you're able to onboard your money on the platform just like you would on Robinhood. You connect a bank account and you transfer funds into a Robinhood account. And now when you want to invest, you just pick and choose the asset that you want to invest in. You say, buy now. And that's the end of that transaction. Whatever disclosures are associated with it, all those requirements are met within the data model. So for us, we use Invenium as a source of truth on our data. You had Sam talk about it earlier today as well. There are true data wall service that we utilize, as well as data integrity service that we utilize. And through that, we're able to provide the disclosure at the time when someone clicks on the buy now button. They just click through through the disclosures, and they're able to go ahead and they're able to purchase those tokens, provided they have fund setting in their accrued wallet as well. Now, we're not using any kind of cryptocurrencies. We're not using any kind of stable coins per se. We don't want that regulator risk or that volatility risk that comes on from using those those kind of coins. We're using purely fiat. And at the same time, we're keeping the entire transaction on chain as well. And that's the unique aspect about Accrue. How do we ensure compliance on it? All of that needs to happen on the back end. Whether you're using Gmail and that uses blockchain as the underlying tech, you should not have to deal with that. Do you know what kind of TCP IP service you're using on your internet connection? Not written, no, right? And that's the thought process of, if you want to use blockchain as a general purpose utility and you really want to benefit from it, that's the only way you're going to get mass adoption and you're going to be able to solve for it. And that's what we work towards, and that's how we developed our platform. And that's, those are the problems that we solve for, both from a sponsor's perspective as well as an investor's perspective. If I need my tax reporting docs at the end of the year, I shouldn't have to go looking in my email or in my mailbox or running through my mail. It should all be available in one central place. Just like on Robinhood, you get all of your tax docs at the end of the year just in your inbox within the Robinhood app. It's the same thing on the Accrue platform. You get all your reporting docs all within your own dashboard. Where do you get all of your distributions, those quarterly dividends that you get on Robinhood? Similarly, on Accrue, it's the exact same thing. They automatically come into your account on Accrue. It's not like, oh, I got to go claim these on a third-party website. Now I want to trade this, so I'm going to go on a different website and I'm going to go to a different ATS. You want to sell your token? Click on this token now. And this is
to make it as easy as Apple Pay, like literally just throwing your phone up, done, or the little chip reader. Because when I bought an NFT, it was like I had to get the Coinbase account, and then I had to deposit it, and then get ETH, and then I had to transfer it to a MetaMask. And then I connected my MetaMask to the website, and I've done really good on that deal, so I'm happy. But tokenization, fractionalization, how is that going to impact cap rates in commercial real estate?
Look, when you're opening up the market to a larger public, you're going to see cap rate compression for sure, which means you're going to have that increase in the value of the asset. What that in turn means is, when you're moving an asset from a private market to a public market, and I know someone already had this conversation a few minutes ago as well, you're adding a premium on it. On traditional securities, you see somewhere from a 15 to 30% liquidity premium that goes on moving from private to public. In this case, it's real estate. It's never going to be a true public market transactional process. It's always going to be an OTC product. And that's how we've set it up. But the premium is still there, which in turn means you're going to have cap rate compression. You're going to have higher prices. You're going to have more demand, and more people are going to be able to buy into at a much smaller value, creating that whole fractionalized ownership concept, as well as democratizing the space and letting everyone invest into it. Even within the accredited investor space, there's a whole chunk that doesn't currently have access to true alts. Their only options are going into a BlackRock fund and having 50K locked in there for the next 5, 7, 10 years, which they may not want to do, because you may need access to capital, which is why people don't choose to do that.
Yeah, that's the most exciting thing to me.